Hi there. So this is a short video about HTML, and the aim is not to teach you how to create HTML document or how to code HTML, but to know what it is and what it does, because we are, for our subject about metadata, we are more interested in XML. But I think it's a good idea that we know a little bit about HTML in order to better understand XML and its advantages. So let's start. HTML, XML, and XHTML, and some other similar technologies are called markup languages. And markup languages are systems for annotating documents. So basically, they are not programming languages. When we write code in markup languages, nothing actually happens. They don't do things the way that programming languages do. They mark up or annotate a document as to its structure or presentation and so on. HTML is one of the markup languages, and it separates content from format and makes a document processable. So computer, like an application such as a browser, web browser, can read the document and process it and takes the markup as instruction and does something with the content. It preserves and gives layout, and markup languages usually use tags like opening tag and closing tag. And what comes between those tags is usually content. And the tags function as instructions for the computer applications to do something with the text or the content between the opening and the closing tags. HTML files are basically plain text files with HTML extension. So if you open an HTML file, all you see is plain text. The file contains some textual document and links to non-textual content such as images, videos, audio files, and so on that are annotated with tags. The current version of HTML is HTML5. Before HTML5, which was released I think in 2014, we had HTML4 and XHTML, but HTML5 replaces those and it is increasingly used on the web. HTML files are meant to be read by browsers such as Firefox, Chrome, Safari, and so on, in order to be shown and understood by humans. So the HTML files are not meant to be processed by a computer and understood by the computers. It is for us humans to see them on a screen or a tablet or a phone or a kiosk or a TV or some other display devices and read them and understand it. So what the browser does, it takes the tags, so it shows you only the content, not the tags, and the tags works as instruction for the browser as to how to present the content within the tags to you. In HTML, there are a list of predefined tags that we can use. Tags such as P, which means paragraph, I for italic, H1 for like heading 1, H2 for heading 2, up to heading 6, I think, A for hyperlink, section for section, and so on. And we can actually see a list of tags, HTML tags here. So we have tags such as A that creates a hyperlink. We have tags such as HR, which produces a horizontal line. We have tags such as like label and so on that for creating forms. We have formatting tags such as B that displays the content as bold, or I for italic, and other tags. So there are 100 plus tags I think in HTML5 that you can see. By the way, if you are interested to learn HTML5 or HTML or CSS or XML or any other web-based technologies, the best resource you can get is W3 Schools. So w3schools.com /HTML is the best source. It's interactive and it has all the information you need to learn about HTML or XML or other similar devices. So HTML is not case sensitive, but best practice is to keep all tags in lowercase. So if you open the tag with P capital and close it with P lowercase, it still ignores your not good practice and it shows the content, but best practice is to keep everything in lowercase. So basic syntax of an HTML file is this. It opens with a declaration. The first line is a declaration, which tells the browser or any computer application that reads the file that what this file is. Doctype HTML. It tells the browser that this is an HTML5 document that you are reading, and please treat it as an HTML5 document. The rest is an opening tag HTML, which closes at the end of the document. Then the document has two sections. One is the head, the other is the body. The body is the content that we can see on the web pages. So all we see on the web pages is the content that locates here within the body tag. And what comes between the head is some information for the computer, such as what is the title, what is the date this page was created, and some other information that we usually put there for like search engines and so on. Let's create our first HTML document. So we can copy this basic structure and go here into a folder and create a text document, a plain text document, and call it my page. And open it and then paste our content here. And you can see we have a head, we have a body, so the indentation doesn't matter, but again, for us to understand, for us to be able to better read the document and edit it later, it's better to do the indentation in terms of the nesting of the tags. So we have a body. Inside the body, let's create a heading 1. So H1, we open the tag and we close the tag. And let's create a paragraph and we close the tag. So inside H1, let's put the content. This is my heading 1, and in paragraph we say this is my first paragraph. In the head there is one tag which is called title, so my first web page, and this is what you see on the title bar of your browser. And let's save this, close it, and change the extension from TXT to HTML. And this is our first web page. If you open it now, you can see that this is the title up there. So the title here is what we put in the tag of title in the head of the document. And this is the heading 1, and this is a paragraph. It's as simple as this. So the rest of every page that you go to, like for instance, let's take this page. If we click, right click and see, say, view page source, what we can see is the same. So we have a doc type or declaration that says this is a document of HTML5. Then we have opening HTML tag, which closes at the end of the document. And then we have a head body, head section opens here and closes here. And then we have a body that comes after and closes at the end. And all we see here on this web page is what is in the body of the document. In the head, we have a title, which you can see here, my first title, and some other information for the computers and search engines and so on. So, in HTML, obviously, we also can edit the way that information is presented. So let's open our home page. When we want to edit HTML, we can edit it with a notepad. And then let's change the way it is presented. So one way that we can change the presentation of information is with the tag of style. So we add rules. So style is a tag that opens here and closes here. Inside the style, what we have is a few rules about how to format the content within the HTML file so it is shown to the user in that way. For instance, we say H1 should have the color of red and paragraph should be shown in blue. And if we save this and we go back to our page and refresh it, we can see that it changes the color of the heading 1 and the paragraph. But this is not a good practice. So there comes another technology which is called CSS or cascading style sheets. Because if you imagine you have a website such as CSU with thousands of web pages, you cannot go to every single page and edit. And you know that universities and corporations every few years come with a new design for their website. And the way they do that is not to go to every single page and change the layout or the presentation or the color of the text or the font size and so on. What they use is CSS. And CSS is again another simple plain text file with an extension of CSS. And inside that there are a few rules like this, a few lines of commands that tells the browser how to format the content of HTML and present it. It has a selector, which is the tag that we are going to apply the formatting to. For instance, here it says H1, and then they have a declaration, and declaration has one section, which is the property and value. So it says the color of H1 should be green. And we can create a CSS file and link it to our HTML file by a line in the head. So if we copy this one, let's go to our so let's take out the formatting from HTML file and keep it clean and create another text document, my CSS, and inside this paste our rules without the tag, because CSS doesn't need the tag, and save it. And then in our CSS, in our web page, we need to add this line in the head of the document. And this line basically says, it says this is a link, and the relation of this link to the document is that it is a style sheet. A style sheet is a text CSS type. It is for the screen and print, and this is the address of the CSS file. So some web pages, you can see that when you go and you see the web page on the monitor, it looks in a way, but when you print it, the print is different from what you see on the screen. And that's the power of CSS, because you can create one CSS for mobile, so the web page is shown in a specific way when you view the page on mobile. Another CSS for a monitor, like a computer monitor. Another CSS for a print, so when the cut document is sent to the printer, it uses that specific CSS, which is used print friendly, and prints the document in a good and nice layout. So here we just change this name of the file to my CSS. And save it. And then if we refresh our page. Oh, we need to change the extension of this to CSS. And then we can see. So we need to fix this error, which replace it with the proper quotation mark. And then the document will look fine. So this is how we can use one CSS to format 10,000 web pages instead of going to all of those web pages one by one and change the font size and the formatting and the layout. We replace one CSS and the entire website of a corporation with any number of web pages can look differently in a new style. And finally, we need to know that actually people don't write HTML code with hand. There are content management systems such as WordPress that people use to edit the content of HTML pages, and they have usually themes and CSS and so on. And these software applications usually have an interface which is called what you see is what you get, which means they show you a user-friendly editing interface such as Word, Microsoft Word, that you don't have to actually change the code in order to make a font appear in different color. Instead, you just change the color and the application writes the CSS code and HTML code behind the system. But the relevance of HTML for us is that as a markup language, it is about mostly the appearance and the structure of the document, not about the content. As you look at the name of the tag, for instance, P, I, and so on, in HTML file, it doesn't tell us anything about what the content is. So it tells us this is a paragraph, but it doesn't tell us what is actually inside that paragraph. So we don't know whether it is the address of a university, the biography of an author, the title of a book or something. That's why it's not a suitable markup language for encoding metadata or preserving data for using across different applications or exchange of data. And it's not good for understanding the semantic, and it's not suitable for understanding of the content by computers. So computers cannot process the content in the semantic way to understand what it is. And that's why we moved for the semantic web toward using XML, which in the next video I will talk about XML and how it is a perfect solution for encoding metadata and also exchanging metadata and generally data. Thank you.